Good morning. Announcement before we get started with a reading in the sermon. This Sunday, the first Sunday of July, we will resume worship in the sanctuary at Shelbina at our usual time of 10 a.m. Honeywell will continue to worship outside at 8 a.m. Shelbina is worshiping inside with masks. And we're using fans to create airflow through the sanctuary, and that way we'll be able to replicate an outdoor situation and not be in the heat of the sun. For those who cannot wear masks or just uncomfortable or claustrophobic, I'm going to have to recommend that you go over to Honeywell or watch online, because as of right now, masks are going to be required as part of worship here. So I hope that many people can join us, and we will just continue to get through this odd year one step at a time. We continue to be looking at the Lord's Prayer in Matthew 6. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think that they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. There were many subtly different ways that Jesus could have said this line, from the most simple, give us bread, to all the other permutations, give us this day our bread, give us bread daily, give us our bread daily. Like, there's many, each of those words has their own nuances, each of those words matter. And so in this very short sentence, give us this day our daily bread, every word matters, and so every word has its own nuance if you emphasize it. And so we're going to look at it. We're just going to quickly go through this sentence and see where we land with it. Right? So you start with give. Are you the very first word? This is the first petition that's focused on us. We've gone through our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. And that's mostly focused on Jesus and his kingdom. And now we're moving towards ourselves. The latter half of the prayer about forgiveness and temptation, and but the first of the requests that we make before forgiveness and not lead us not into temptation is the most simple: give bread. Right, and so we begin by looking at this need for us to be given. We are, as humans, as people, we always need to be given. We cannot eat by ourselves. We need to receive, or else we will starve. And so this first word, give us this day our daily bread, the first word reminds us that we are to stay humble, to be willing to ask, please give. And how often do we need to receive? We need to receive daily. Give us this day. Right? We are not just needy when we are having a bad day, when we're feeling down. It's easy to feel, that's when it comes naturally to feel needy. It is reminds us, give us this day. It reminds us that we are receiving, even on our best days, we are always receiving. We're always needing to ask to be given. And we're asking for something particular. Give us this day bread. Of all the things that we could ask for in the Lord's Prayer, to ask for bread is the most concrete, tangible, basic thing we could ask for. Bread is the basis for meals. It's the starch, right? It's the bread that everyone that was listening to Jesus speak, it's what they would have eaten day in and day out. It's bread. It's not delicacies. It's not whatever food we want. It is the simplest food. It is what we need. And if as as we hear this, give us this day bread, yes, there are echoes then of the bread that is provided to the Hebrew people as they journey through the wilderness, the manna, the bread that they are given to sustain them. And yes, there's also echoes to the bread that is given to us in communion. This is my body broken for you. And what is it that is broken? It is bread, bread that is broken for us. So that every time we look at a table and we see bread on that table, we are reminded of Jesus who gave himself for us. So give us this day bread, and give us this day daily bread. Now, it might feel a bit redundant to say that, like, give us this day our daily bread. But it's not actually, right? It's we receive daily, and how much should we receive each day? We're praying, give us this day, and how much are we praying for this day? We're praying for our daily bread. We're not praying for give us this day our weekly bread, or give us this day our monthly bread. Right? If to ask for our weekly bread would be to be asking, give us enough so that we don't have to pay attention to you the rest of the week, right? Give us this day our weekly bread, I'll have this weekly bread, and then I'll pray again in a week. No, that's not how it works. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us enough for this day, knowing that if we attempt to eat more than our daily bread, there are consequences to that. The spiritual consequences of greed, right? If we try to eat more than our daily bread, we're saying that we're going to be greedy. And it's not just the spiritual consequences, there are also the physical consequences. If we eat more this day than our daily bread, if we eat enough calories for 2 days, on one day, that's overeating. And that has its own consequences as well for our health. And so it is, give us this day our daily bread, so that we might not attempt to walk without God the rest of the week, so that we might not be greedy or overeating to our detriment. Just give us this daily bread, what we need for today. And then there's one last word that pulls this sentence together. It's the pronouns, right? Give us this day our daily bread. It's the our daily bread that reminds us that it is a communal product. Right? There is no such thing as bread that we can make by ourselves. But even if I make bread by myself, if I go back to my kitchen and I make bread, the bread had to be grown by someone. The wheat had to be grown by someone. Then the wheat had to be ground by someone. Then it had to be had to get to the store where I could buy it. Someone had to put it on the shelf. And think of all the steps necessary before I can make bread. There are a lot of other people that had to be involved. It is our bread. There is no such thing as just my bread. It is our bread. The pronoun reminds us that we are asking for the product of a community, being in this together. It strikes me in this season to pray, give us this day our daily bread. It is the hour that really jumps out at me. For what we need right now more than bread is to be gathered together, to be eating our bread together. I doubt that anyone that is hearing this sermon is going without bread at all. If you are, let me know. I'll get some food to you this afternoon, right? But what there is are people who are eating their bread alone. They're not eating our bread, they're eating bread. It strikes me that we never know of Jesus eating alone. If we read through the Gospels, I can't find a single instance where Jesus eats alone. Right? Jesus is always eating with someone, and in doing so, he is bringing them far more than bread. He is now creating a moment of our bread. And when we are gathered around and sharing our bread, then we are becoming community. We're giving each other more than food to eat. We're giving each other ears to hear and voices to laugh together, a person to serve and a person to be served by. Right? To eat our bread is to receive far more than just some calories. It is to receive what it is that we need that nourishes us. Not just food, but we are receiving this belonging, being part of something that is more than ourselves. We need our bread right now. We got plenty of bread. We need our bread. We need companionship. We need to be with each other to eat our meals. That word companionship, I am a sucker for etymology and looking at the roots of words. Come means, C-O-M means with, and the pan, P-A-N, is the root word for bread, right? Companionship is what we need, because companionship means to eat bread with someone. Like that's what the practice of companionship is to sit down and share our bread, and that's what we're missing. All of us have plenty of bread, but we don't have much of our bread. We need to be eating together, and we're missing the events that help make us. At Shalbina, it's the fish fry that we're not having. At Honeywell, it's the shindig. It's the impromptu meals. It's the times we see each other during the week. And we're missing those things, right? The last time that I led worship with people in a sanctuary was on March 15th. And I remember the date because it was the day that we were having our corned beef meal after worship at Shalbina. And I was making like 70 pounds of corned beef. And we knew that the governor of Missouri was about to announce something that Monday. And it was going to be complicated. We weren't sure what. And so I was sitting there cooking 70 pounds of corned beef and taters and cabbage, thinking, I'm going to have leftovers forever because no one's going to come. And then everyone came, and it was awesome. And there were no leftovers, which is, I'll cook some more next year, so we'll have some more leftovers. We went to take meat and meals to other people in the community, and that got a little bit tight. So I'll cook a little bit more next year, so we have some more leftovers to share with people. But I had this sense that we wanted together to have our bread together, because there was a sense we might not get to for quite a while, and we haven't. But in that moment, we were together and we had our bread, and it was one of the high moments for me of this year, is to be able to have our bread together. And I got to tell you, I'm hungry to do it again. I want to, right? It's what my prayer. Like Martin Luther gives us some advice on prayer. His advice on prayer is that God has no need of everlasting twaddle. He does have a way with words. But Martin Luther said, God has no need of everlasting twaddle, that prayers ought to be brief, frequent, and intense. And my brief, frequent, and intense prayer is that I want to have our bread together as soon as we can, because I miss it. I have plenty of bread, but I need our bread. So I want to switch gears, and I want to tell you a little bit of frustrating history, and then I want to give you a bit of what Paul says and land with some good news. So the bit of frustrating history goes back to the middle of the George W. Bush presidency as he was heading into his reelection. His campaign staff made a realization that has shaped our politics ever since. What was realized was that there would be a higher electoral advantage by running to the base instead of attempting to motivate independents and people in the middle. There would be, so instead of trying to get people in the middle who are convincible to say, oh, I really should vote for this guy, instead they realized, I should focus on the people who are already convinced, and the focus needs to be on making sure that they are excited and that they are the ones who are going to be sure to vote, right? And what another part of this realization is that the thing that most get people out to vote, the thing that really just drives people to vote, is not so much as excitement about your candidate, but what is far more effective is fear of the other candidate. And so this has become the way that as I think back on this, I was just reading about this understanding, this realization in the last couple of weeks, but that aligns with my experience of politics in my adult lifetime, that we have moved from any attempt to attempt to sway the middle and independents, and now we have this sense of trying to motivate the base, that each party tries to motivate their base, and it's not so much excitement about who your party is pushing forward, it's fear of the other person. And so this sense of fear and anger about what they are going to do, there's a sort of topics that are sort of wrapped together. And so if we bring up, maybe just pick a political topic in any of them, right? There becomes this sense of I'll get angry about that because they would mess that up. They would mess it up badly. And then that triggers a whole bunch of other political topics as well. We bring our anger to issues of gun rights and immigration and abortion and voting rights and voting access, and you take all of these hot topics and we can sort of roll from one being angry about one to angry about the next to angry about the next and fearful about what the other side will do. And what is deeply unfortunate is that right now in an election year, the two things that we can do that will help move us closer to being able to gather to have our bread together, the two things that we can do that would be most helpful for us as a church to serve our church and to serve our community, to get us closer to being able to gather together to have our bread together again, safely, have become politicized and become part of this sort of us and them type of right and left type of dialogue that has taken over our politics. And what I'm talking about is masks and social distancing. Right. And mostly it's the masks, because that sense of wearing a mask has become this sign of a political stance, and that is deeply problematic right now. And I say that first as a scientist. I spent 4 years studying biology. I have a degree in it, and I don't use that degree often, but every once in a while it's nice to dust it off. And I can tell you, based upon studying science at some length, that what the health department is telling us is grounded in research and is wise, and I'm keeping track of what that research is saying, and based upon what that research is saying is why we are able to reopen the church this weekend, because the science has shown us what is the best practices for staying safe: airflow, masks, social distancing, right? And so I can tell you that the most effective thing we can do to ride out this situation, to keep ourselves healthy and to keep those we love healthy, including those in our church, is to wear masks when we are inside, to practice social distancing, and that's just what will work, right? That's what will work. And I will gladly meet with anyone who has any questions about the science of this. I will go over it with them, and I would prefer to do it on my front porch, not inside, simply because I don't enjoy wearing a mask any more than anyone else. So that's what I know as a scientist about this. And what I know as a pastor is that I'm here to serve you, and I know how much we need to be able to gather together for our daily bread. We need to. Our future as a church is wrapped up in our ability to share our daily bread, our ability to reach out to the community in the fish fry at Shalbina and the shindig over at Honeywell, our ability to develop and grow the youth group at Shalbina. They eat together, and that's essential. Our ability to be a church and to know each other and to love each other and to pray for each other is rooted not just in worship together, but it's also in the meals together when we can listen to each other. The Honeywell, the Lord's Acre Sale, the Ice Cream Social, our future is dependent upon our ability to eat together. Right? Our bread together. Give us this day our daily bread to eat with each other, to eat with the community. Like, we need to be able to get back to eating together. And so I can tell you that it is good science to wear a mask and stay 6 feet apart, to take it seriously, right? Take that very seriously. And I can tell you as a pastor that we need to do it because it is the quickest way we can get back to what we need to be doing as a church. And it is deeply unfortunate that wearing a mask has gotten sucked into this political churn of trying to cause us to be angry and fearful of what they will do. And the best person I can turn to advice in the middle of this is Paul. Because what Paul does is Paul writes to the church at Corinth, and he tells them on multiple topics. This is in 1 Corinthians. He tells them on multiple topics to be the church, Right? You've got a better way of doing things. Be the church. He looks at them. The church at Corinth has some people who are suing each other. And he looks at them and says, "You, that might be how other Corinthians do things. You've got a better way. You follow the Prince of Peace. Get together and follow what Jesus has to say about reconciliation." It's right there in Matthew. They hadn't numbered the chapters yet, but it was Matthew 18, right? You know what you need to do. Just go do what Jesus says. Don't go out and do what the world does. That's not going to work. Stay and do it like Jesus teaches you. You have a better way. Right? And then later on in 1 Corinthians, Paul is talking to them about this challenge of meat because they are they're debating what they should do about meat that has been sacrificed to idols, to false gods. And so Paul is talking to them and he says, yes, you might have the right to eat meat, but that's not the right discussion right now. It's not about your rights. It's about how do you love the person next to you? How do you love your neighbor? How do you love your neighbor starting with a person who's in the pew next to you? They hadn't invented pews yet, but the point stands. How do you love the person next to you? And if the way that you love the person next to you is to not eat meat sacrificed to idols, then don't. Right? Paul tells them, right? It's not about your rights right now. It's not about what everyone else is doing. It's about doing what Jesus teaches us to love our neighbor. And that logic seems to be the best guide I can find for today. We are praying for our daily bread so that we might be able to break bread together. And as we work our way back towards communion together, meals for the community, the best tools that we have to line up what we pray for and what we're doing, so the best way we have to line up our prayers and our lives is to wear masks when we're inside and with people, to maintain social distancing, and that's what is going to work. Right? And to resist the siren call of making masks as sort of political statement, becoming part of this never-ending drama of cable news and us and them, you know, whatever. We follow Jesus, and wearing masks and social distancing is the quickest way we have to get back to having our daily bread. That's just what it is. That's what we're going to need to do. Now, the good news is that as I read through Scripture, I read through the stories of many people on journeys. I read of the ark going across the waters. I read of the Hebrew people going through the wilderness. I read of the disciples and the years learning from Jesus. I read of Paul on his lifetime of journeying from city to city. And the prayer that all of them prayed, whether it was the Psalms or the prophets, and finally the prayer that Jesus taught them to pray, is that, please give us our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. And God did, and God went with them through the journey. And right now is no different. We're in the middle of this journey through this time, and we will get through. Praying this prayer that God would give us our daily bread, being confident that we will be provided what we need, and we will learn the new practices along the way that we need to make it possible for us as a church to continue to follow Jesus. God has gotten God's people through many a tough spot before. This is no different. God is with us. We'll get through. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come humbly to ask for our daily bread, that we might be sustained until it truly is our bread again, that we might be able to gather as your church, as your people, be able to be gathered as your disciples, be able to serve our community in doing so. We pray for that you sustain us until that time. We pray that this church might be exactly that, your church, a group of disciples faithfully following your Son, and thus in this time of tension, of so much concern, that we might be the people seeking peace and reconciliation and justice. We pray giving thanks for those leaders who are leading towards this peace. We pray for the repentance of those who are not. We pray for those who are sick in these days. We pray for those who are mourning the death of loved ones. We pray for those who are traveling during this time that they might travel safely. We pray for our communities that are struggling with the challenges of race in the way that we have inherited the scars of previous generations' racism, and we still grapple with what to do with that today. We pray for the wisdom of those who face those challenges, that might there might be change one step closer to your kingdom. We pray for all these things as we pray the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Peace be with you this day and always. Amen.